Now that the damage is done, it's time to start the rebuilding process. It's time to pick up the pieces and get our lives back in order. Part of that process involves dealing with your insurance company, and I know that can be a little bit difficult sometimes, so we're going to simplify the process today with 9 tips to file an insurance claim after disaster strikes. My name is Andrew Finney, your real estate geek. If you need help finding a top agent where you live, or if you simply want to drop me a line to say hello, my contact info is below. If you're new here, please go ahead and subscribe to this channel now and like this video. Tap the bell icon to get notified of the next one. Okay team, let's get into it and lead in with somebody that's going to be probably your best friend or someone that can really help you and guide you through the insurance claims process. That person is called a PA, which is actually a public insurance adjuster. What a public insurance adjuster does is they work on your behalf, kind of like a CPA that goes to bat for you if the IRS calls you in for an audit. Is the same thing that a PA will do with the insurance company to help you get your claim filed faster and help mitigate your expenses quicker and help you get the best return possible on your insurance claim. So let's talk about the 9 tips. The first one is be safe. It's important to remember in places like Houston, New Orleans, and Florida, it generally only takes 3 to 5 days for serious mold problems to develop. So if your property's been flooded or sustained any other type of water damage or major water damage, you'll probably need a respirator and a face mask to safely enter your property. I know it's enticing to get in your property and survey the damage and start picking up the pieces, but there are things that we need to do to make sure that we stay safe and that we keep you safe, and things that we need to do in order for the insurance company as well. So please definitely avoid going back into the property until it's safe, and don't endanger your life. It's not worth it. Let the water subside. Get the appropriate professionals in there to mitigate any risk to you. Now, there is a site I'd like to share with you, whether you're looking up filing a claim right now, or if you're simply were curious and you clicked on this video. That site is ready.gov. Ready.gov is your source for emergency preparedness for any natural disaster and man-made disaster. They have a wealth of information. I'd highly encourage you to click the link. It's in the show more description below, and ensure that you have an emergency preparedness kit ready to go just in case you ever need it. Let's hope that you don't, but if you do, at least you have it. The second tip is to immediately notify your insurance company that you have a claim. By filing your claim right away, you are more likely to settle your claim quicker and find a local high-quality contractor sooner. And the sooner your claim is settled, the quicker that you can start rebuilding your life and putting the pieces of your life back together and getting your life back to normal. So it's really important to go ahead and get that done as quickly as possible. So you have 4 options to file a claim. The first one is to contact your local agent. The second one is to call the special 800 number the company sets up. The third one is to log into your online account if you're able to do so, and the fourth is simply visiting a mobile claims office center. Getting that process started is going to help you get your life put back in order more quickly. Now, it is very, very important to note that flood insurance is separate from your homeowner's policy. If you did not have flood insurance through the National Flood Insurance Program, or NFIP for short, then you're probably not going to be covered. Fortunately, there are a couple of links that, again, are going to be in the show more description below if you don't have flood insurance, that you'll want to visit and see what kind of assistance is available to you. So you want to visit the disasterassistance.gov website and also the floodsmart.gov site for more information to see what they can do to help you out. So let's talk about a silver lining in all of this, right? If you have comprehensive coverage on your auto, more than likely you're going to be covered if it was flooded in the process. The third tip is to ensure that you establish the pre-loss and post-loss condition of your property. If you're wondering what a pre-loss and post-loss condition of your property is, think of video, think of photography. So what you want to do, and if you haven't done it yet, you want to get in the habit of doing it, is every year make sure that you're snapping photos of your home. And as a pro tip, I would suggest ensuring that those photos are actually timestamped with the date and time that you're taking those photos. Why would you want to do this? Well, if you change insurance carriers or if you have a claim, it's very common for an insurance carrier to say or argue that the damage was there before the natural disaster happened or the man-made disaster happened. So you want to make sure that you have annual photos or annual videos of your property on the inside and outside of the property, showcasing what you have to ensure that you can provide a pre-loss condition of your property, and nobody can dispute a picture and a video. So I actually suggest doing both of them. If your home is damaged and you don't have videos or photos, you can verify its pre-loss condition using holiday photos, MLS photos if your home was on the market, an inspection report, or even a recent appraisal if one of those were completed. If you have receipts for furniture, appliances, or other work and improvements or home improvements and upgrades you've made on your property, those are also helpful in this process, which goes back to the importance of maintaining a homeowner journal and backing up your homeowner journal on a cloud device, so even if it is lost in the disaster, that you have it in cloud storage. Now, after you've documented the condition of the property with your photos and videos, now for the post-loss, right, you want to go back in and snap all the same photos, do all the same videos, so that you can show the pre-loss and the post-loss condition of the property. After you've established that, then you want to go ahead and begin the cleanup. You don't want to make any repairs at this point, because doing so constitutes what's called spoilage of evidence. The insurance company has the right to investigate the loss, move furniture away from walls and other places where there is damage, making viewing easier. The fourth tip is your policy requires you to mitigate damages. Now, if you're wondering what mitigate damages means, it's taking the steps to prevent any further damage. So in other words, if sandbags are needed, if it looks like a secondary flood is going to come in, you want to place the sandbags in, and again, yes, take pictures, videos of that, show that you were mitigating the damage and from anything else happening. As an example, let's say that a tree fell on your house during the disaster, causing a hole in your roof. Now, obviously we want to mitigate that damage. What could we do? Well, we could simply put a tarp over it showing that we mitigated damage. And of course, we want to make sure that we snap a picture showing that we were mitigating damages, right? It's only going to work to your benefit as you work with your public insurance adjuster and make your case a lot easier for them to solve and go ahead and pay out to you, okay? As a silver lining, the good news is that most states require insurers to reimburse mitigation expenses within 30 days. The fifth tip is to understand the provisions for loss of use and displacement in your policy. It's important to know what's going to happen if your home incurs major damage, where are you going to be able to live, what's going on while the home is being repaired or replaced, who's covering the living expenses, and where are you going to stay. Even if you have a provision for this in your insurance policy, a lot of insurance companies won't pay for it beyond a year. So this means that you as a homeowner are generally in a race to finish the repairs before the living expense money runs out. And again, if you don't have flood insurance, then unfortunately you're not going to be covered for flood related living expenses. It's extremely important that if you live in a flood prone area to make sure that you have flood insurance. Please get it if you don't already have it. The sixth tip is to examine your policy and understand whether you have a cash or a replacement value in effect on your policy. Regardless of whether your home is damaged or not, check the current insurance policy to determine if you have cash or replacement. The big difference here is that a cash value will only pay you on the depreciated value of your property, while a replacement value will replace everything. The full cost of replacement is definitely the best choice. Of course, it's normally a little bit more money, but it is something that is well worth the cost should a natural disaster or man-made disaster hit your property and it's covered by the insurance. It's very, very important to understand that the replacement value is better than a cash value, okay? If you want an example of how a cash value policy would work, think if you had a 20-year roof that is 5 years old and your roof would have depreciated by 25% if it needed full-on replacement. So then you'd only be getting 75% of the value of your 20-year roof since it only has 15 years of a lifespan in it, whereas in a replacement value, you would have got the whole thing replaced because it's part of your policy, okay? The seventh tip is to avoid lawsuits. By getting into a lawsuit, your attorney will be working on a contingency basis while the insurance company's attorneys bill hourly. So obviously the insurance company's attorney is going to want to draw out the process as much as possible because they're getting paid more and more and more money, and they're just going to delay with your depositions, your examinations. They're going to take a look at your financials and they're going to keep presenting delays. The bottom line here is to ensure that you have a good public insurance adjuster and only litigate when necessary. The eighth tip is, what is the cost to hire a public insurance adjuster? State regulations determine the fees that public insurance adjusters can charge. In most states, the maximum is 10% of the entire claim amount. As a caveat, if the homeowner has been partially reimbursed before hiring a public insurance adjuster, then the public insurance adjuster can charge a higher percentage of the remaining balance, but it can never exceed the 10% of the total claim amount. The ninth tip is avoiding a bad apple. Now, a bad apple happens in any profession. You have good apples, you have bad apples, and we want to make sure that you find the best apple for you to help you with your insurance claim. So as you're looking for your public insurance adjuster, there's four things in specific that you want to do. Number one is to interview at least three public insurance adjusters and ask them for references. Just like finding an agent and a mortgage loan officer and everything, you want to Google them, check their online ratings, their reviews, and ask for references of people that have worked with them and make sure that they're the right PA for you. The second is to ask the PA how long the process is going to take. The third question is to ask them what is the average length of their files. This is important to note because it's the number of pages that go into you filing your claim. Less would normally indicate they might be prepping your file for a litigation just to send it off to an attorney, and more might be that they're documenting everything to get ready to submit it and work on your behalf with the insurance company. Keep that in mind. It's really important to know that, okay? And of course, you want to know how successful they are with how many cases are settled versus the ones that go to litigation or appraisal. Extremely important to know that. Ask these questions up front to ensure that you're getting the right public insurance adjuster for you. I really hope this video has been helpful to you today, and here's what I'd like you to do is tell me what you're thinking about this episode in the comment section below, along with any of your other tips to filing an insurance claim after disaster strikes. Now I'm going to go ahead and pop up my contact info if you simply want to drop me a line to say hello, or if you need help finding a top agent where you live, please let me know. Always love to hear from you. Always here to help you. Thank you. If you haven't already done so, I'm going to ask you to do three things. Number one, please subscribe to this channel. Number two, please like this video. And number three, please share this video around with someone you know is going to be able to help, because someone just like you right now is wondering what happens after disaster strikes and what's a good way to ensure that I get my life back in order, back on track, and moving forward again. Please share it with them. It'll really help them out. Thank you. In between now and next time, I'm wishing you and yours a lifetime full of love, wealth, abundance, and happiness. Thank you for watching today, team, and enjoy an amazing day.